challenges. And I've prepared some slides to give you some examples, especially around those criteria that are always difficult to unpack, just to see how I have done it in the past. So although I'll be drawing mainly from my experience in Australia, but most of the tips are applicable in any setting. So, planning a grant, planning to write a grant is a challenge. And the biggest challenge is when you plan to write a grant without understanding the audience. And when planning a grant, you have two audiences. The first audience is the agency providing the fund or advertising their research grants. And the second audience is your own employer. So you need to ensure that whatever you're going to put forward, not only it fits the funding agency's research priorities, but also that it can be supported by some of your organization's area of research strength. If you fail to really articulate your grant within these two parameters, then you know that your grants may not necessarily be competitive. But I'll touch base on some of these issues anyway. First, you need to look back, try to understand whether really you are aware of the funding agency's mission, some of the research priorities, some of the guidelines and the rules, exclusion and inclusion criteria, because you don't want to waste your time putting together a grant proposal and then to realize at the last minute that you are not going to be eligible. So you need to ensure that whatever put forward is not only fits the funding agency's area of research priority, but also that you are supporting your own institutions in terms of sustainable research, meaning that you know you are tapping into an existing program where you can show long-term sustainability. Or if that was not the case, you may be augmenting area where the institution is building some track record. So you're augmenting already something that is taking taking place and building traction. Or you can actually be an opportunist if you have enough enough social capital and try to improve an area of research weak performance. Where you think you have track record, but the institution or may not have that track record, but you can mobilize enough human resources to be able to build that area of weak performance. So lifting an area where the institution may be lacking. So that could descend really well with the funding agency. Or you need to ensure that you understand the scheme the research scheme you are applying for. Remember in Australia, it's about, I'm reluctant to use the word, but unfortunately, I can say it, but it happens a lot. When you're doing research, there is what we call elitism. So the research scheme will have a lot of value attached to it. So they are ranked according to the prestige. So make sure that you understand the prestige associated or attached to the research scheme you're applying for. And then you need to be sure that you have enough time to put together a very competitive research proposal, building the team and have enough time to write the proposal. Now, in Australia, as you know, we have four different schemes, and each one of them has its own, as I said, its own prestige. So like if you have a category one grant, then you are among the cream de creme. And so, but to get there, it's not it's not something you will achieve over one night. So usually we start with if you are an early career researcher, you want to start building your track record into category three and build your way up until you can reach a stage where you are competitive for category one grants. So when you apply for promotion or you apply for higher level positions that are research oriented, they will try to look at the proportion of your research and how they are distributed across the categories. So in a nutshell, category one is what we call our Australian National Competitive Grants, where they are advertised nationally, and every person has an equal opportunity to be aware of the grants and can apply for them. So there are various types, but the most competitive one are the National Health and Medical Research Council and also the Australian Research Council. Then you have the category two, which is other Commonwealth grants, as well as a state and territories research schemes. Then you have the category three, which is more of the NGO, the UN, United Nations agencies, and philanthropic organization. And then you have category four, which is more of the cooperative research centers. So, you know, you start with a category four, you build your way up. So the creme de creme is category one. So once you've attracted one of those, you know, you're going places. Now you need to be aware of, before we apply, you need to be aware of the needs versus want. So the need is something, you know, what I'm calling need in our research is something you can't live without. You can't be a researcher if you don't have a food to put on a table for your family. You can't be a researcher if you don't have employment. So you need to ensure that. The first thing, you want to ensure employment. You can make sure you have enough. You're bringing in money to be able to feed your family and to sustain your, you know, to live a functioning life. So which means you need to have employment, and getting employed is not easy. So most people finishing their PhDs may not necessarily have a ready available employment. So the first thing is, if you have a good track record, to go for a fellowship. And so the fellowship, the advantage is you get your salary paid for, and your research program, if it's a good research program, funded for the duration of your fellowship, which is good. Then once you have employment, then you can start attracting, addressing the want. So building your track record in terms of knowledge generation, which is around all the projects, project oriented. I'll touch base on those. Or trying to build the capacity, the research capacity, building the human resources in your area of interest. So such as the Center for Research Excellence, or some programs, partnership programs, et cetera. So I'll touch base on each one of those. So why fellowships are very important. So especially for those who can't secure, you know, a tenured track position. So they may, you know, they don't have a teaching program they can tap into. They don't have a research program. So in order to secure employment, fellowship could be one of the options, or tapping into somebody who has established program like me, where then I can build in a postdoc position where you are attached to my program or my project as a postdoc, where then my program will be paying for a salary, while to allow you to build a track record to become competitive in the market. Or if you are lucky, then you can or have established a very good track record, and then you can start undertaking your position and, you know, have an employment and start building some wonderful programs. But your capacity to build programs, research programs, will depend on your employment, reality. For example, some people have what we call 60-30-10, meaning you have 60% research, 30% teaching, and 10% service to the community. Or some may have 80% research, 10-10-10, or those who don't have enough track record in your research, but are lucky to have a teaching, then we end up with 8% teaching and on 10% research and 10% service. So you need to balance your employment conditions, try to understand the employment conditions to ensure when it comes to performance appraisal, you can justify your employment portion. For example, if you have 60 or 80% research oriented, then they expect you really to have your output around research to be as solid based on your level of employment. If you are A, B, C, D, E, then there will be different way of appraising your performance. Now, before you put in an application, you need to ask your question, for example, how competitive you are going to be given your research scheme. For example, if you are going for a fellowship, you know, fellowship are oriented toward you as an individual, how you have performed. So if you have done your PhD, your narrow career researcher, done research, your PhD by thesis, you may not be as competitive as someone who had done it by research, for example, by publication. because those with publications have already output under their belt, so they may be ahead of you. So you need to start. Whereas if you did it by thesis, it may take you a couple of years before you can even publish your own data from your thesis. So you need to try to weigh up your options. How competitive are you? Then if you are competitive and you are going for a fellowship, because it's about you, do you have a mentor? Because if you're not attached to a mentor with a track record, strong track record, you may not succeed, because the government need to make sure that if they give you their money, you are working under somebody who will mentor you to become successful, somebody with a strong track record, with an national standing, who will coach you, mentor you to become successful, because the fellowship for 5 years, then after 5 years of mentorship, you are ready to take the next step. So even if you are competitive, but you don't have a mentor or a good research environment, you may not necessarily be competitive. And then in addition to your track record, you need to put forward a competitive program. I'll touch base on what I mean by competitive program as we go forward with my presentation. And then you need to understand that you've researched your funding body's success rate, because the success rate matters a lot. If the success rate is very low, then you need to make sure that, have you spoken to previous successful applicants to understand to have some of the insight of what could maximize your chances of becoming successful. Then you need to ensure you are ready now, you have all of the data, you understand where you stand in terms of your chances, you have a good mentors in place, your research environment, you have a data on your research environment, you are ready to craft something. Now, the first things I always say is make sure you have a very good catchy title, a title that really can give an indication of what your research is all about. Because, you know, most assessors will be assessing 100 applications in a day. So if the title is putting them off, you already lost their interest. You need to ensure that you are catching them. They want to read your application. That's key number one. And then once they read, you need to make sure your background is really spot on. Have you really identified what already we know in your area of expertise, and what are the gaps you are trying to address? One of the biggest issues, and when I'm assessing applications myself, one of the biggest issues that let most applicants down is when they try to do everything. You can't solve the world's problems in one application. So once you know the gaps, choose the gap you think closely align with your track record and interest. Stick to it. Don't try to solve all the gaps in one application, because then you'll be setting yourself to criticism of setting a bigger program than you can even achieve given your timeline. So you need to be careful there. And then you need to have to ensure that your objectives are very clear and achievable, and you have clearly stated hypotheses that can be tested. And the way of testing that is, for example, what we call the PICO or PICOT or PICOS, depending on your field, all these are terminologies we use. So in nutshell is, if I read your application, I read your title, I see your objectives, your background, can I understand who is or what is your population of interest? Can I really articulate, can I read the application and know what is the population of interest? Can I understand if it's an intervention, what is the exposure and the intervention, the exposure, and whether you have a comparator, depending on whether it's experimental, non-experimental design, or if it's an observational design, do I understand the events? You know, what are the events? Do I understand what are you are trying to assess and how you are going to assess it? And then, are the outcomes clearly stated? Is the timeline feasible? And is the study design making sense? Then you need to ensure that whatever put forward is really based on pilot study, because if you are putting together a grant, you are putting forward with that pilot study, it will be killed, because you have no chance of demonstrating that you have a track record working with the community, your target population. You have not a track record to show you can recruit them. You have no track record of having trialed some of your frameworks to ensure that they are culturally acceptable. The community have been trained. They can be involved in your data collection. They can co-own some of your design. you have no track record of the tools or instrumentations you are putting forward that can be tested and is they are robust and the questions are understood by the community, etc. You have no track record of whether the sample size calculation or the power of the study is informed by your previous studies. For example, if it's a cross-section studies, your pilot study gives an indication of the prevalence, and based on the prevalence, then for a broader, bigger study, your pilot prevalence can inform your sample size, for example, and you run the risk of not coming up with an adequate budget, because without an adequate sample size informed by pilot studies, without clear instrumentation, how they'll be implemented, whether they need bilingual workers, whether they've been trained, your budget could be underestimated and run into serious trouble. So you need to make sure your pilot studies are the driving force of your grant application. And if you don't have pilot studies, making sure you're building the people you are bringing on your team can at least have pilot studies you can piggyback on to justify, there's a way you can be creative to piggyback on your team members' pilot studies to try to put forward a robust application. And then you need to make sure you can articulate the significance of your study. If you can't really articulate the significance of the sort of study, if I give you my money as a government and you do the study, you implement your study successfully, the sort, what difference will it make? You need to be able to articulate the benefit, the societal benefit of your study. Otherwise, it will be very hard to sell to assistants. And some studies will ask you, some funding agencies will ask you to produce no more than one page of the expertise and productivity of your team. And then in addition, for each team member, you need to produce a two-page document that highlights the career, the career summary, top publication, especially the last 5 years, and justify why. So it's not easy to justify why you chose your publication. You need to give an overall track record. You need to give metrics for research output, contribution to your research, to the field of research, mentoring supervision, research translation, research leadership, international standing, professional community engagement, and services, a service to the community. It's not easy. So you need to put together a two-page document that can address these criteria. So in Australia, this an example of our funding schemes. As I said, so it can be either a fellowship, it can be under a project, or it can be under a program. So an example for our National Health and Medical Research Council. So we have, you have like a, what we call fellowship. So investigators grants where you put in for your salary and research. So to be funded for a salary, and also plus they will fund your research program. Or if you are already employed, then you can put in projects application, such as such as a synergy grant, or such as development grant, clinical trial and cohort, etc. Or you can put in a program such as a Center for Research Excellence, like not so long ago I submitted my research, my Center for Research Excellence in Migration and Health, because that's where I have a track record. So I'm waiting for the review, the outcome for the review process. If it's the Australian Research Council, the same, you can go for a program partnership such as a linkage, you can go for fellowship such as future fellowship, which is salary, or you can go for programs such as ARC Center for Excellence. Now, if you go for fellowship, be aware of really some of the challenges. Some of the challenges are, you understand that this is an example of ARC fellowship. You can see almost 50%, it's about you as the person. So your track record matters a lot. So which means if your track record is not good enough, you've lost around 50% of the whole assessment criteria. So which means you need to really make sure that your track record is in order to make sure you are competitive. So you can see you as a person is almost 50%. If you go for NHMRC, it's no different. You can see you as a person, which is 70%. You as a track record as a person, so your publication, your research and the leadership. You as a 70%, the rest is only 30%. So if your track record is not good enough, you can see your chance of getting that fellowship is gone. You know, it's your chance of competing is reduced. So that's why our field is still being referred to as, you know, publish or perish, which is it's a label I don't like, but unfortunately, if you're going for fellowship, that's the key. Then, what are the things we'll be looking at under your investigation? It's your PSM, so you need to articulate your research opportunity performance. So of course, like we come from public health, we're different from social science, so you need to be appropriate to your field, because some field they have a very strong journals, with good impact factor. Other field, the journal impact factor may not be as good. So you need to be adjusted to your field of discipline. Then you need to articulate your research leadership, in terms of mentoring, in terms of institutional leadership, etc. And also you need to demonstrate your capacity to bring people together, to collaborate both nationally and internationally. Then you need to show that your project quality, even though it's around 20%, it still matters. You need to show that what you're putting forward is of good quality, addressing gap in knowledge. It's novel, you're not duplicating non-knowledge, that you understand the theoretical foundation of your research, because most people put forward an application, but there is no clear theoretical foundation that link your objective hypothesis and your design. So you need to make sure the theoretical foundation of your application is very clear, whether there is cohesion between the design, implementation, and the team. Because, do you have a team with the right complementary skills and competencies who will then complement whatever you do with clearly assigned role and responsibility to ensure that there's cohesion during project implementation? So it's like a marriage. You don't have to marry someone you're going to divorce after 2 years. So can you put together a team that from the beginning of your grant to the end, there wouldn't be any divorce? If there's any sign of divorce, then you are finished, because then how do you know that it's a partnership? So you need to show track record of working together, you've collaborated before, so you know each other. In other words, there is no potential source of conflict that may split the team into two, or even people run away because of conflict. And then you need to show, again, collaboration is the key element. Then you need to show benefits, the benefit to the wider community. Like in Australia, they stand very strongly, it's very strong about how much would your research add to the Australian community? What difference would it make? Whether it's cultural, social, economic, environmental, whatever it is you need to articulate. If you can't articulate it, then chances are your application is not going to be competitive. Then you need to articulate the feasibility and a strategic alignment. For example, as I said, feasibility is, your study is very well couched within pilot studies. The pilot studies have informed your design. The proof of concept has been trialed. All the methodological approach, recruitment, instruments, tools have been piloted. The budget is really clear that you're providing value for money. Otherwise, if you overestimate your research, there's no value for money. You don't want a comment like a good research addressing really an area of public health significance, but too expensive and not value for money. So you need to make sure you are balancing up your argument to ensure that you don't get caught offside. And pilot studies become really a way of ensuring that you don't underestimate or overestimate your budget. Because if you don't get enough money, then you can't implement, you'll be caught with your project, can't finish because you underestimated your budget. You under budgeted your project. And you need to ensure that your organizational research environment is really the statement. Usually, like me, I go to my university, my school, to ask the research office to give me a statement of our research environment, where they're saying how much income they've got as a school or as a faculty, how many PhD completion, what's the research themes of strength. So you need to make sure you're working with your organization to come up with a statement that will give a good indication of the area of strength of your department to start with, then your school, and then your university at large. So when you see most universities talking about how they've been ranked worldwide, you may take it for granted, but they matter a lot. You're saying you are ranked in the top 2% of the world, it matters a lot. It's because you are doing a good job. So you need to make sure all those metrics are captured in your application. But unfortunately, most applications tell you no more than half a page. So you need to be creative in your writing. So I want to give you some example now. For example, here is an example, and I'm using myself, not that because I'm to boast, but more to give you an indication of why, how I do it to make myself competitive. I'm using myself rather than using somebody else. So the first thing is to show your contribution to your research, your field of research. So I tend to emphasize that I'm new to the academic, and despite being new, I've produced tremendous output. But it's not the number, it's also the quality of my publication. The quality, I have to put measure of quality, such as how many citation, my H index, et cetera. Now, if you don't have the big number of publication, there's a way of being creative. Like earlier on, when I was starting my career and my H index was not good, then I wouldn't present H index. There was some, if you have internet, Google, download the Publish or Perish. It's a freely available database. And if you put your name there, it gives you some wonderful, wonderful, wonderful metrics, such as your G index. My G index that I sold more than H index in area in my career, but now the H index gives me more traction. They're different. So you need to be creative. So you need to show your research income, and you can see how much I'm emphasizing category one grants, to show that, you know, category one grant has been one of the mainstay of my research income generation. So it's very important. So to show the prestige of the source of research income. Then you need to justify, as I said earlier, one of the criteria is give your publication and justify. So for example, is there a publication that is from a funded grant? Fantastic, saying, no, you're showing that each time you fund me, I will produce really wonderful output to position Australia as a country that's really influencing research thinking around knowledge generation, et cetera. Or if your outcomes, your research output led to a grant. So you need to show that you are not just publishing, but your publication is making a difference. That's how you start justifying your output. So you need to choose your publication. So they ask no more than five, ask for no more than five. So you need to choose the one you think are positioning you as somebody they can't, an assessor will look, I can't ignore this application. This somebody really doing a good job. So you need to be really very strategic. Then you need to show the translation. What difference, for example, me and my team finish a rapid check review, which not only we published, but changed around how the New South Wales was allocating money to refugees. Fantastic. That for me, you can't beat that level of translation. Another example I didn't put here, I finished the biggest evaluation. I do a lot of work in Uganda, and those who are in Uganda know already all my work in Makindye and the Nakawa division, evaluating OZ, Australian funded government around slum areas since 1914. And that work has been taken up by the UN agencies, other NGOs, as best practice in addressing poverty in slum areas. Fantastic. I didn't put it here, but depending on which application I'm going for, I'll put it there. Another example, I did another work for the UN in Mozambique recently in 2018. And that has transformed the way targeting an emergency is done. So fantastic translation. So you need to show example of how your research is changing not only policy, practice, and guidelines. So you need really to be documenting your impact. Another example, you need to outline your commitment to whether you are into like a board. Don't take this for granted, being on the editorial board, but choose carefully because you want to be into the what we call the poor journals, especially predatory journals, your reputation of being a starter. So you need to make sure you know the kind of journals you are associating yourself with as a board member or editorial member, because if then you are associating with it, especially with a proliferation of open journals, you need to make sure that you are not really reducing your reputation by associating yourself with predatory journals. So then you need to identify your area of esteem, professional esteem, whether you've been ranked or acknowledged, or whether you've been invited or in task force, all the esteem invited by the minister to address the government, or whether you've been a part of an inquiry, all those esteem, they matter a lot. You need to, the esteem factors, they matter a lot. You need to make sure you are highlighting them in your application. Then you need to show your mentoring, how many PhD you have mentored to. Here it's not how many you have, but how many you have you supervise to completion. That all matters, because if you have them, they don't finish, then you're in serious trouble. Then how many you have co-published with as a result of you being a supervisor, you know, how other, because it matters a lot. For example, initially I didn't mention earlier on when justifying your research output is, so in public health, I don't know in social science different, but in public health is early in your career, you want to be first offer because you have a knowledge generator. As you move into middle career, you want to be second or middle offer to show collaboration. But as you become a leader, you need to be the last offer. So then when I look at your publication and you are in middle or toward the senior, but you are still first offer, it shows you don't collaborate. So chances are people will all speak on you. So you need to show that not you are a knowledge generator, then you become a tremendous collaborator, and now you're the leader in your research area. So, whereas in social science, people tend to publish a solo author, you know, I don't know. So in social, I don't know how it works. Or sometimes I hear some journals will tend to list author based on an alphabetical order. So you need to be aware of the criteria in the field and maximize, use the approach that gives you more exposure, et cetera. Then you need to emphasize your award, et cetera, to show that you are competitive. And you need, if this is an example of my 1.6 million funded program, give an example of how before I was funded, I used pilot study to show that not only I had the framework that has been trained, but also I could recruit, screen, and the consent, the screening rate is good, the consent rate is good, and once they consent, the enrollment in my intervention is good. I know the attrition, then I can address for, so dropout, I can adjust for it for my budget. The program I'm going to give has been trialed, et cetera. So you can see in my trial, I know it was the impact, even though it's not good, but it will inform the power of my intervention. So this, once you give this in your proposal, it's very hard for assessor not to see that actually you are building, you are coming from a strong, solid base rather than giving something which you can't justify. So I was able to show that the tools I'm putting forward, the instrumentation have been trialed. I know how long it will take to administer, so I can budget for. There's evidence that they're culturally appropriate, and they also they wouldn't compromise my what to call internal validity, meaning that, you know, it will measure, they will measure what they intend to measure. And the impact would be compromised because they are measuring something they are not measuring. So they've been really well trained. So once you have your pilot data, you have your metrics, you are now ready to go. So this is my last slide. You are ready to go. Before you go, before you submit the application, you need to ensure that everyone on your grant has sent you a consent to be listed as a team member. The danger is you submitting your application and somebody have listed, come later saying, you put my name in your grant, I never gave you consent. So that becomes, it can become a killer. Make sure that everyone you put on your application, they've sent you an email in writing, consenting to be listed as an investigator. Most universities will help you with that. But it's your responsibility to ensure you get those data and you have them, you have the data stored in your computer. You need to ensure that you have benefited from your organizational internal review for application to ensure that you don't violate any exclusion criteria. So that's where you work closely with the institution to ensure that the compliance is spot on, but also that you've benefited from some of your team members' review for your application, as well as some of the application will pay for external reviewer to review application to maximize your chance of getting becoming successful. Now, once your submission is done, it's not the end. because later on you receive assessor's review of your grant. You need to prepare a rebuttal. Now, some rebuttal, some assessor's reviewers can be really mean, you think it's the end of the world. Others could be very sweet and wonderful. Be careful, just because they are sweet and wonderful doesn't necessarily got it. In actual fact, most of the grant I've got is when they had no hope because the review was so negative, but actually you don't know the score. So when you prepare rebuttal, be careful, be respectful, make sure you address the comments, not the assessors, because if you start attacking the assessors, it wouldn't sit well with the panel chair. So you need to make sure you respectfully address the comments, outline the area of disagreement, and give evidence, give a main point of view. So be authoritative and don't be argumentative. By being authoritative with evidence, you're more likely to convince the chair. And then after your rebuttal, it goes to the chair, the panel will convene, and until the outcome, the results are announced. Once the results are announced, successful, fantastic. A bottle of champagne, enjoy. Unsuccessful, don't despair. It's not the end of the world, because I've been lucky where some applications are accepted at first submission, but also I've been unlucky where submission becomes successful at the second, third attempt. And so use your failure and the assessor's comment to strengthen your application so that you maximize the chance of acceptance next time you resubmit it. Some institution, if you are near miss, they'll give you more money to collect more pile of data to enhance. Some others, they leave you hanging. You need to find a way of improving it yourself. So use all the resources available to maximize your chances of acceptance on second or third submission. That's it, and I hope I've given you enough tips, and I'll be able to answer some few questions.
Thank you, Jacob. Yeah.
Hi, Charlotte. Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor, for your very brilliant presentation. You touched on very important issues that are applicable at all levels of academic life, student life, those already teaching and researching, and also leaders, as you just said. My role is to open this time for questions. If you've got a question, please feel free to put up your hand. You can also write in the chat. Yes, let's start with somebody who has put up their hand. I can't see who. That's Magnus. Yes, please feel free to put on your mic and ask your question.
Okay, thank you so much for this opportunity. Prof, it was a wonderful presentation. I'm very grateful to be part of this. But my question is, for someone who is running his PhD program, who have not applied for any grant before, and possibly his recent publications are of recent, and in a grant that he or she wants to apply, he's talking about indicating publications that you have done in the past, not recent. So what would the person do in order to scale through in that application?
Yeah, so as I said, that's why I'm saying most grant will ask you to highlight your publication over the last 5 years. So it's your recent, not your past. But where you fall though, if you don't have that history of publication, fall is when you start justifying your H index, because your H index is driven by history, citation. So in justifying your five publication, it'd be easy because based on the last five years, you can be creative. Where you may fall short is when you start giving your metrics, because your H index, your G index, or your whatever metrics you put forward is driven by history of publication, your publication history. Because a paper published 2021 may not have attracted enough citation, as one you published in 2012, for example. So depending on the grant you are applying for, the best thing to do is, and I don't know, I'm speaking roughly, if you are applying for a fellowship, then make sure you have a mentor with a very strong track record. We can piggyback on their track record to show that if funded, you are working in the right environment and you are going to reap the reward, for example. So that's number one. So your environment matters a lot. So if you are not creative, because I know some research tend to be selfish, they don't open up, or some mentor may not say, I don't want to take you on board because they think you are going to be lazy, or they think either you are not going to produce the goods, or you're going to be a burden, asking too much of me and distracting me from my. So you need to, the mentor, you need to convince them, to your responsibility to convince them that if they take you on board, you never let them down. Because most people think that I'm going to mentor, is going to take me on board. No, no, you still have to convince me that if I take you on board, you are going to give me the good, you are going to produce and not become a burden or distraction to my program. Now, once you are on board, my role now to show you that I will give you the environment, the support to harness your talent and make you as productive that at the end of 5 years, you are a star. So use the opportunities available to you. Either if you don't have a track record, use your environment, whoever you work with, the people associate yourself with, their track record, to justify that if you are given a chance, you have a good structure to make you a very good researcher.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Nzao, for responding to that question. Peter, your hand is up. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Professor. Most of what you presented is like, I was just nodding my head because it's like some of them is like I'm now currently experiencing them because recently I'm applying for an HMRC grant and some of them. But going back, like you said, most of, especially for HMRC grants, 70% of the assessment is about you, your own track record.
Yeah, if it's a fellowship.
If it's a fellowship. And then, like what the previous person just asked a question, you're just coming from your PhD. And, you know, in terms of publications, okay, you're okay with it. Maybe you have good publications, you published during your PhD, and you even in terms of citations, you have relative, because again, relative to opportunity, I can say, relative to the time you finish your PhD, the number of publications and the number of citations you have, your H-index, or now even in, I think in, people talk about the FWCI index. Mm-hmm. For me, the issue I have is with regards to translation of your research finding in terms of policy, in terms of practice or whatever. For someone who is just finishing, let's say who has just finished a PhD, and let's say your PhD maybe was your first program of research, formal program of research, and especially for us Africans per se, most of the time it's like your PhD is, that's the case, except maybe you have been in a research environment prior to that. It's difficult for you to really articulate that your work has really created, the most impact it has created is knowledge. But when it comes to in terms of economic or social or whatever, it's so difficult. So how do you go through, my question is, how do you as an emerging researcher for a fellowship, especially like just investigative grant or whatever, how do you really go through that hurdle in terms of articulating your impact?
So within the NHMRC, there are different levels. The early career, the fellowship for early career, for middle, and established leaders like myself, right? But You need to be, James, I'm following your publication on LinkedIn and I enjoy reading your papers, Baba. You are doing a good job. You have to know that. I read every single paper you post on LinkedIn. You're doing very well. But
thanks very much for that.
Each time I read your papers, though, they are very good papers. Then the question is, remember the translation need to be driven by you. For example, recently there was a review of a pharmaceutical, which is an area you work in, a pharmaceutical process in Australia. Did you make a submission? Because that's your area. You just finished a PhD in that area. So if you make a submission to the government, that's a way of influencing. So that's how you're influencing policy. Did you position yourself that if there's an inquiry, you are the person to come to, for example, that the way of influencing policy? Did you look at the guidelines and pharmaceutical, try to influence? My research came up with guidelines. You wrote to the guidelines. I think these are not working for it. So in other words, translation, you have a role to play because no one is going to wake up. Oh, I know James' work. I need to read it. No, you need to be the driving force to create opportunities for your own research to be taken up either by politicians, by policymakers, practitioners, and those developing guidelines. If you don't create that for yourself, even after 10 years, 20 years, you still don't have an area of way justifying translating your research into policy practice and guidelines. Does it make sense?
Yeah. I get what you just said, and you said, it's like you have to be more proactive. You have to sell yourself more, you know, especially when it comes to policy translation for people to, especially those that aspect, you know, the policy and the community at that level to really recognize what you are doing, and then.
And if for example, I know you are, which university are you again? I think
it's Southern Cross University.
Yeah, Southern. So like if you're working with a leader at Southern Cross in pharmaceutical who have done translation, then as an early career that you're saying, if you fund me, I'm working with a big hitter in research translation. So although I'm new, by working under him, I'll be able to not only borrow from his approach, how he's translated it, but also use his approach to enhance my own influence in the field. So what I'm saying, you need to be, so if you don't have someone to associate with, then you are stuck. So if you're early career, you don't have someone to associate with, there's no track record to piggyback on, then become, that's why I'm saying success rate for fellowship is only 15%. So getting a fellowship, you know already, I checked this morning before presentation, the fellowship in HMRC was 15%. Imagine 15%, that's the success rate. Trust me, it's not easy. You keep going, keep banging, one day you'll get it.
Thank you very much for a brilliant discussion. I can see there are other questions, so my apologies for cutting you both, Peter and Professor Rinzau. We've got another question in the chat. I will come back to you, Magnus. Let me just check in the chat. One of the questions relates to you, Charlotte, as well as Professor Rinzau. Are you going to be able to make the slides or the presentation available to participants?
I'll send the PowerPoint. I sent Charlotte, I'm happy for her to circulate it, no problem.
Thank you very much. So there are two other questions. They are from me, so I'll just ask now. My first question relates to the research that you have done in Africa. Glad that you have done that research in Mozambique and other countries. It's good to see that as part of your huge list of publications. So are there any lessons that you are able to share with us in relation to the research that you have done in Africa, not in relation to the research itself, but to improvement of research in Africa, funding for research in Africa, improving research capacity in Africa? Are there any themes that you have derived from that process, Professor?
I'm glad you asked this question. Trust me. Like I have research in Laos, I have research in Nepal, I have in Africa. And when you compare the environmental challenges, it's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. But there are those that are unique to Africa. And I had to be acrobatic. So I usually I'm not sporty, but I had to be acrobatic to overcome. One of them is most funding body will never really approve your research unless you have ethics approval. Like in demonstrate, in Africa, there's no institute. Like I have to piggyback on Makerere. So to piggyback on my, like go through Makerere, which means then if I need to bring someone Makerere I never worked with to facilitate the process or getting ethics approval. So it becomes really a challenge. And I still believe in Africa, one of the biggest innovation. I'm thinking one day it could be one of my innovation is to establish what I call an Africa Multi-Country Ethics Committee, not only to facilitate collaboration between North and South, because I think the challenge in Engage South is that capacity around ethics, ethics approval clearance. And there is this conflation between government approval and ethics approval. Government approval doesn't replace ethics approval. Government approval doesn't give you ethics legitimacy, right? Mm-hmm. So then when you get ethics approval, then you're dealing with government machineries. Oh, you have ethics approval, but we haven't given you permission to operate. And so that's one of the biggest challenges. The other big challenge when it comes to translation is when the government are vetoing how much can go out and can be said about your research because of political sensitivity, whatever. So the question of the ethics and moral obligation is, should you keep quiet of about the fundings because you upset the government, which means you miss the opportunity to change practice and influence how things are done? Those are the biggest challenges in Africa. So as I said, when I'm in Uganda, I use the Makerere, but the drawback is bringing people I've never worked with to allow me to access the Makerere Ethics Committee. Because if I get my ethical approval here at Western, it's not still, it's like I'm importing the Western colonialism, where I'm saying I'm getting the Western, I'm bringing, no, I don't like that. I want to make sure that my research in Africa is approved by an African-owned ethics approval, not an imported ethics approval. Does it make sense? So that has been my driver to avoid importing the imperialistic approach to research in Africa. When I'm in Mozambique, I use the Ministry of Health. They have a de facto ethics committee, which I've used. When I'm in Swaziland, there is no way I can get ethics application in Swaziland. I have to go through South Africa. So I've done all the resilience research in Swaziland and Lesotho, and I've produced a wonderful Ugandan PhD on Swaziland and Lesotho. Actually, all my PhD in Swaziland are Ugandan, who I funded, trained, did all the research publication on Swaziland and Lesotho. And so those are the challenges. Those are the challenges. Ethics approval processes and knowledge dissemination and translation and the conflict between the right of a researcher for knowledge translation and the political imperative. So, but I don't let the political imperative deter me or deter my drive to make sure my research is known by the UN, the NGOs, and the government. But so what I do though, to bring the government not to upset them, and the Uganda is very good. Uganda really wonderful government to work with. So the way I do is when I'm in the field before I leave, I will organize like what I call a pre-field exit presentation to key ministries and government, ask for their feedback, and then asking them if there was a funding that's sensitive, what will be the best way of still conveying the message without creating political tensions. So once you take everything they give you on board, then you are ready to go and you will never create any problem.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much, Professor, for your feedback on that. I do like especially the issue of decolonization that you've talked about. It's really important in relation to African research. I also do like the issue of having an ethics committee that is Africa-wide, that is cross-country. It's an important issue. And at the African Social Work Network, we've got the African Independent Ethics Committee. Of course, it's focused on social work and development and social science related issues, but I'll be happy to discuss that further with you. I've got another question in that relates to publications in Africa, the publishing industry itself, research itself, but the publication industry itself. Have you had a chance to look at it, and what do you think could be done to improve it?
Look, the challenge with, there are three challenges in Africa. So, and that's where I'm caught between myself saying I don't want to import colonialism, but then I have to choose between, should I publish my work in Africa where people are saying, hang on, professor, you see what you're publishing? So that's more the final line I need to negotiate, because most African journals are of low, poor impact factor. I'll give an example. The free issue. So they don't have the profile, like impact factor, but there are some times where so I close the impact factor still saying this research is needed by Africans. I'll say, okay, I'll still put it there because I want the Africans to know about it. but I will make sure it's no more than 10% of my output on Africa, because otherwise no one may not read it and search me. That's the question. Then the second is the way African journals are managed. You submit to an African journal, 2 years later, they haven't even, hasn't reached the editor. Do you imagine you submit to an African journal in 2021, by 2023, the editor hasn't even looked at it. So by the time even you get reviews comment, your research is relevant. People have already published your area, then you lose the momentum. Capacity building African journals actually to become creative, knowing that you know research is fluid. You can't just sit there. I understand that they don't have enough resources. I understand, but then it becomes a disincentive on how we overcome our own challenges back in Africa. So that's issue number three. And issue number three is that when you publish in Africa, is like, I did a map, for example, in an area of public health, journals in public health, to try to see which country has the best best journals. The closest I could come was South Africa, right? South Africa, at least, you know, you get, and there's two in Kenya, the Eastern African Medical Journal, et cetera.
Yeah.
But the majority of the journals, there's no big difference. It's like they're copying each other's model. You ask yourself, what's the innovation? So which means then become disincentive to submit. Look, I still do some, but not a lot. When I think it's needed to go back to Africa, I'll do that. But in order to still maintain my profile in terms of citation, H index, I'll still go global.
Thank you very much for that insightful response, Professor Nzau. I think another way that we could contribute is to engage in the publications themselves, in the publishing itself, creating publications that will be that will meet the standards that we see at international level. And I think with people like you, with the skills that you have and the passion that you have in your area, that's possible. And again, it's also another area to decolonize the disciplines when we ourselves set the publications that we desire. Let me go to Magnus. You have been raising your hand for a long time. Sorry about that.
Thank you. I really enjoyed this, honestly. All right, so first I would like to know your LinkedIn ID so I can keep close tabs and learn more from you outside this platform.
Then my second question is,
I want to know.
I'm on LinkedIn, you can't miss me.
Okay, sir. My second question is, what is the perception of grant assessors in terms of MSc research grants? You know, sometimes I do see MSc research grants published, you know, but I want to know, MSc, Masters. Yes, I want to know the perception of research grant assessors. That's my second question. Then my third question is, are you open to cross-border collaboration with emerging researchers like us so that we can also learn?
I support emerging researchers. And I'm telling you, I've produced so many Ugandan PhD in Africa, not here, where I either give them scholarship that they do best from invest by based in Africa. No, I collaborate with you. You are welcome to, if it's an area of my interest, and I always collaborate. So in terms of research and master of science, I don't know what you mean, but at the end of the day, assessor will still assess you based on those indicators. Are you publishing? If you're publishing, are you publishing good journals? Because if you're not publishing good journals, what you don't hear is saying, Magnus publishes a lot, but not all the journals are of poor quality. You don't know that, right? In other words, you rather publish one good article in a good journal than 10 articles in a bad journal. That's how we see it. The tendency in Africa when you deal, like when I get application for PhD, African PhD, potential PhD student looking for a scholarship, and one of the common issue I tend to find is you find somebody has a 15 publication, but the open journal never heard of. When you Google, the most of the journals are predatory journals. I will never even attend that application. right? Whereas there are some good Ethiopian students, like especially those coming from Ethiopia, they've mastered the art of publication. You get a student from Ethiopia for a PhD, you are sitting on a gold mine. They will never let you down. There are machines, they understand their stuff, they're publishing very good. They have mastered the art. When you look at Ethiopian, when you look at Zimbabwean, they've mastered the art. Eastern Africa still catching up. I'm not saying because I haven't gotten a lot of application. I get application from Nigeria. Nigeria, they've crafted their art, and the advantage with Nigerian, they come also as a paid student, especially Western Africa, which is good. So they are good, paid, so they are not a burden in terms of scholarship, which is good. And when they come here, they work, they pay their fees, everyone is happy. But what I'm saying, the majority of the application, I would say like 30%, depending on the region of origin, the region of origin will determine the quality. But the majority is publishing in the bad journals. Usually I will never entertain that because I know, even if I send the application to the university for review, they say, hang on, Andre, have you read the application? Did you see where they publish? You know, they open a journal of management in Kawala, whatever. So when you Google, it's a predatory journal or a journal no one has ever heard of. So you need to make sure it's not the degree per se, it's more the quality of what you are studying and you're producing. It doesn't matter whether you did it at Makerere, you did it at in Congo, you did it in Liberia, Sierra Leone. At the end of the day, actually, it's the quality of your work, not the location. And because that's what people think, maybe you come from an English speaking, you're giving priority. No, I know a little bit Congolese here. A lot of Congolese have scholarship, PhD scholarship. They are French speaking. They got scholarship based on the quality of their work. So at the end of the day, that's why like the assessment criteria in Australia and in many developed nations, they are objective in that sense. In other words, if you produce good quality, you'll be given an equal chance regardless of whether you speak good English, as long as you can communicate and write and express yourself, that's what matters. Mm-hmm. Of course, you still have to pass your English score, but if you can write, meet English score and produce good work, then you'll be evaluated equally across the board. I don't know if that answered your question.
Thank you. Thank you very much for asking that question and Prof for your response. I'm mindful of our time. We've gone past our scheduled time, but there was somebody whose hand was up for a long time. I think it was, I can't see them now. If you are there, please just turn on your mic and ask your question quickly. Thank you very much. That was Milton. Milton Kwesiga.
Okay.
Please go ahead. Okay, it looks, yes, Milton is back. Please go ahead with your question. We can't hear you. We still can't hear you, Milton. Please unmute, Milton. We still can't hear you. Yes. Charlotte, can you? Okay, yeah.
Yes, sir. I'm Kwesiga Milton, a PhD student in the College of Agriculture and Environmental Sciences at Makerere University. The presentation has really motivated me. I was losing morale. I was almost giving up because of the challenges. But now I'm motivated. Thank you, Professor, for the presentation. I, however, have a humble request. Is it possible to have the contact for Professor and also need for further your further guidance and mentorship in research, because I'm now motivated.
Sorry, I didn't catch the question. Can I?
I'm just in request for your contacts and also your continued mentorship and guidance in research issues.
Yes. So what's the question?
The question
is sharing the contact. Are you okay with sharing your contact?
I'm sharing the contact. It's, my email was on the first page. If you email me with any question, I'll show you the email again. I showed the email just in case. That's my email. It's a public email. I don't hide it. So you can reach me anytime. Or if I saw most people send an email requesting a copy, I couldn't write all the emails. So if you shoot me an email, then I'll be able to reply with a copy of the PowerPoint. And also Charlotte will have a copy. She can circulate to everyone who attended.
Yes, we'll supply we'll share the slides and also the recording. Can we complete? Because I know you are giving us only 1 hour, and we are.
Yeah, no, that's okay.
Yeah, we don't want to. Yes, I'll leave Jacob to give a vote of thanks, and then we can close.
Yes. Thank you, Charlotte, for that. Let me begin by thanking those who attended today's event. We have got members of the African Association of Schools of Social Work. We also have people from the East African Regional Social Work Resource Center and members of the African Social Work Network. I've also seen other participants from other institutions, especially in Australia, but also in Africa. Thank you so much for participating, asking questions, and listening to Professor Renzawa's presentation. I also wish to thank Charlotte for organizing this event from day one. Thank you, Charlotte, well done for the work that you have done. And lastly, to you, Professor Renzawa, thank you very much for coming to present. It was good listening to your presentation, what you have gone through, what we are doing, and your ambitions, especially for Africa. I think we do share a lot in common, and hopefully we'll be able to sit down and discuss how we can address some of the challenges that Africa faces in relation to research, but more importantly, how to mend our upcoming African researchers. I think it is our role, and we do need to play that role. With these words, I'm happy to say this marks the end of our meeting today. Thank you.
Thank you so much.